Good afternoon. Welcome to all of you. I am Nanjan Swami, Assistant Professor in the Department of Civil Engineering, SJ College of Engineering, Mysore. Today I am here to discuss a topic on lateral earth pressure, which is a subtopic of geotechnical engineering too. Before going to the details of lateral earth pressure, we will see what are the things which you are going to learn in this particular session. In this particular session, you will be knowing what is the importance of the concept of lateral earth pressure, and then what are the states in which lateral earth pressure can exist in a soil mass, and finally the how to find the earth pressure coefficient. When we talk about lateral earth pressure, before going for defining the lateral earth pressure, we will see some of the applications where we need to find the lateral earth pressure. And out of many applications, the most important one is the retaining wall or retaining structures in general. We all know that what is a retaining wall? A retaining wall which retains an earth on one side, which is an elevated place. We'll see few of the slides where the retaining structures are provided for different kinds of civil engineering structures. Let us check where we are providing the retaining structure to begin with. Here is an example. Whenever we required a grade separation for highways or maybe a railway and a highway crossing, then we go for what we call underpasses or underbridges. And in this case, the side walls of the underbridge, what we call abutment walls, are nothing but retaining walls. As you can see here, the retaining wall on the side here, it is retaining the earth or soil mass on this side, as well as here, this retaining wall also retaining the soil mass. These are the typical examples of abutment walls of bridges. Here you can see the abutment wall adjoining to the bridge structure here, similar one. And here, of course, this is a typical example of reinforced earth retaining structure. Again, another photograph of abutment wall here showing the retaining wall structure. This is a approached tunnel for crossing, and the side walls here, what you are observing is nothing but the retaining structures or retaining walls. This is a common scenario in majority of the metropolitan cities. Nowadays you are seeing lot of works in the area of transportation infrastructure where flyovers are very common. And one such thing here we are seeing where the ramp structure for the various types of flyover structures here are made out of retaining structures, retaining walls. Again, another view of the ramp structure. On the sides of the ramp structure, naturally we need to provide a retaining wall for the purpose of retaining the earth or soil mass on this side. Whenever there is a difference in elevation, as you are seeing in this picture, difference in elevation is there between the highway and the land on this side. Naturally, the soil mass which is present here over is to be retained by means of a retaining wall. So the adjoining property, if it is to be stable and safe, naturally we are going to provide a retaining structure over here. This is a typical view of a retaining wall protecting the structure above over here, and a parking lot which is below the natural ground level over here. And again, this whatever wall we are seeing on the adjacent side is nothing but a retaining structure. A typical railway track which is running through the city areas, where you, on the side of railway track you will get lot of buildings or other types of structures, etc. There, naturally, they are generally an elevated place, so thereby the adjoining soil mass is to be retained by some kind of retaining wall like this. A swimming pool, for example, is also a retaining wall. I mean, the wall of the swimming pool wall, whatever you are saying, surrounding it, is nothing but a retaining structure. It retains the earth on one side, the water on the other side. This is a typical example of a port structure. In a port, the land area, whatever is there here, for the purpose of loading and unloading, etc., we have what we call platforms, and those are to be protected by a retaining structure like this. A sheet pile is named here, is a kind of a retaining structure here. It retains soil on one side, earth on one side, the other side it is subjected to the water force. These typical walls are called as quay walls in harbor and port structures. So, different types of quay walls are available, but basically they are all nothing but retaining structures. So, these are the typical pictures of port structures where retaining walls are provided. This is the famous one, as you all know, Palm Island, okay, in Gulf country. The entire island is surrounded by a retaining structure like this. It is built on a reclaimed land in the sea, and thereby naturally that entire area is protected by means of a retaining structure. Another typical case here, so the entire length, whatever you are seeing, is a quay wall structure protecting the soil mass on the backside and the structures built on this particular platform. So this is another typical example of a retaining wall here, just by the side of waterway. Here you are seeing the retaining structure on which the embankment is also supported. Many other structures are supported over here. So this is a case of a retaining wall supporting the adjoining property on a waterway. Typical example of sheet piles, which are again used for the purpose of retaining structures, as retaining structures. So you can see here the sheet piles are embedded inside the ground to protect the earth mass over here when compared to the other side structure, etc. Another example of sheet pile again. Near waterways, again the land on the other side is to be protected by against sliding, etc. So again we are going for what we call retaining walls. Another typical example of retaining wall on the waterway. So here again, this is a typical example of reinforced earth retaining wall provided for a roadway by the side of a lake. This is another kind of retaining structure, what we call soil nailing technique. The soil mass is embedded with the bars or rods into it, and it is made stable without sliding. So, and the surface of the soil mass is just covered with a kind of concrete, that is what we call generally shotcreting. Any kind of other coverage can be also be given, but commonly it is employed, which is what we call shotcreting. So this is again a retaining structure here, but built-in retaining structure over here. This is the common problem or generally requirement in the majority of the places. Whenever you have an embankment, the top width of the embankment initially was decided to some width, and for a highway, let us say, or for any other kind of thing. For a future date, if you want to increase the top width to a larger size due to some reason, like demand in increased due to traffic increase or any other kind of requirement arises, then how to do it? One way is increasing the top width and maintaining the slope, but that requires large amount of space at the bottom, which is generally not available in developed places or built-in areas. So naturally what we are supposed to do is we need to increase the top width over here, and to protect the earth mass, whatever we are going to fill over here is to be given by means of a retaining structure like this. So naturally here a retaining wall is to be built, and in this particular example you can see this is before construction, that is the available width was small, and this was an embankment, and at the bottom of the embankment there was a road. So naturally there was no scope for having larger space at the bottom to increase the top width here with the same slope. So thereby naturally we need to go for a construction of a retaining wall like this. And this is during construction and this is after construction. So and one thing what we can observe here is during construction also the traffic at the bottom road here is not affected, because the technique what they used here is a reinforced earth construction for the purpose of building this retaining wall, and hence it was quite fast and not obstructing anything over here, and hence it was completed in a very short time. This is actually a photograph taken from a city in Japan where they have increased the top, and this is generally the common scenario in majority of the places in metropolitan cities or mega cities or even medium sized cities. And this is again another scenario in mega cities or metropolitan cities where the high rise buildings are quite common. And when we go for high rise buildings, naturally to provide the parking space, generally they go for what you call construction of cellars, and one or two floors of cellars generally taken below the natural ground level over here like this. So once if they go below the ground level to provide the space for parking structure shown in this particular case, naturally we have to build certain kind of walls like this, and these walls are called as basement walls. These basement walls are nothing but retaining walls to protect the soil mass surrounding it here by sliding. Okay, so here naturally these basement walls are essential to protect this soil mass over here. So these kinds of retaining structures are essential in majority of the places. So we have seen so far the examples of retaining structures where we are providing the retaining structures, and which are the places which requires the provision of retaining structures. Naturally the proper design of retaining structures are very much essential, because if the retaining structures are not properly designed, then the failure of such retaining structures are going to cause huge amount of economic loss and even maybe life loss. So to avoid these things, naturally the retaining structures are to be designed properly. When we talk about the design of retaining structures, the first thing which comes into picture here is a thorough knowledge on the lateral earth pressure. So in this particular session we are going to look at what is lateral earth pressure, how it is going to develop or how it is going to mobilize, and in what state it can exist in this soil mass, and how formulate the things required to find out the lateral earth pressure. So we'll move on to the definition of lateral earth pressure or the provision of lateral earth pressure. See, we know that if you take say for example water, water exerts pressure in all the directions of same magnitude, generally called as hydrostatic pressure, because it is there is no shear, naturally it will possess the same amount of pressure in all the direction. Whereas the solid mass, okay, they don't have such a kind of a property, and thereby there will not be any lateral pressure for that solid mass. Whereas this soil, which is a particulated matter, okay, which the behavior of this is slightly different from the solid as well as from the liquid or fluid. So here if you look at this, the if you consider a small element of soil over here just adjoining the retaining wall, then the various particles that are present, they exert a lateral pressure on the wall, and this is what we call lateral earth pressure. The vertical stress produced due to the soil mass above any surface, that is what we call generally call it as overburden pressure. That is one. The other one is the particulated matter naturally offers some pressure or some thrust, some force on different directions. So naturally, when we talk about the earth pressure, the direction of earth pressure is also important, because it is not same in all the directions as we see in case of water. Therefore, the direction of earth pressure is to be mentioned properly. And in this case, in retaining structures or in any other soil mechanics problems, whenever we talk about earth pressure, commonly we are referring to what we call lateral earth pressure. In the lateral direction, what is the magnitude of lateral earth pressure that is going to develop? That is what we are going to speak. Now, this lateral earth pressure, okay, along with the vertical overburden pressure, is going to formulate the whole problem of earth pressure analysis. For further discussion and in future classes also, in order to bring up the concept of lateral earth pressure and theory of lateral earth pressure and the formulation of various methodologies to solve the problems of lateral earth pressure, I am going to refer this particular sketch. And in this sketch, I am shown here the cross section of a typical retaining wall. Don't worry about the different types of retaining walls and shapes, etc. This is just a representation for the purpose of discussing about the concept. So thereby, I am just considering this as the retaining wall here, and this is the base slab. And whatever the earth that is retained on the back side of the wall is called as backfill soil, or in general simply backfill. So the backfill may be, the top surface of the backfill may be a flat surface like this, or it could be having some slope, upward slope or downward slope like this. If the slope is towards the backfill, we say it is negatively surcharged. If it is up like this, then it is, we call it as positively surcharged. Here the angle beta is nothing but as surcharge angle. Similarly, the wall can be vertical like this, or it can have some splay like this, or what you call batter. And here this theta is again represent the angle of batter what we are going to have. And if it is towards the backfill, it we consider that to be positive batter angle. And if it is away from the backfill, we consider that as a negative batter angle. And on the front side here, you may be having some ground surface. Generally, it is not exactly matched with the base slab. Some slightly above that, it will have the ground surface on this side. So there is a difference in elevation between that ground surface here and here, and hence the necessity of a retaining structure over here. So this particular case, I am going to consider for explanation of the concept of lateral earth pressure in future, as well as the for solving the problem related with earth pressure. So now we have horizontal stress or horizontal pressure due to lateral earth pressure. We have vertical, and if you consider any element, okay, these two are nothing but the principal stresses, because this element is free from shear on the horizontal as well as vertical direction. Hence, these two become the principal stresses, major principal stress and minor principal stress. And whenever we talk about the lateral earth pressure, it might exist in three different states. One we call it as at rest state, and another one is the active state, the last one is passive state. Now we'll come to these three states. We'll try to find out what is the difference among these three states, and which one is to be considered for the purpose of design and so on. Here, if you look at this, at rest state, as the name indicates, when the soil mass is at rest, that means if there is no expansion or compression experienced by the particles of the soil, then that state we call it as at rest state. And whatever thrust or whatever pressure that is going to develop in that particular state, we call it as earth pressure at rest. So in the absence of any lateral expansion or compression of the soil, the stress produced within the soil is can be given by this relation, what we call sigma h is equal to k naught into sigma v. Here sigma h and sigma v, we are as seen here, the vertical stress and the horizontal stress. The horizontal stress is nothing but the lateral earth pressure, and the overhead burden pressure we have sigma v. And here k naught is nothing but the ratio between the horizontal and the vertical stress, and it is called as at rest earth pressure coefficient. Okay, it's a dimensionless quantity, and this ratio, the horizontal to vertical stress ratio, is called as earth pressure coefficient. And since we are considering the state as at rest state, so naturally this coefficient is called as at rest earth pressure coefficient. The typical example for at rest state is if you consider a ground, horizontal ground, having some soil mass at some depth. Okay, naturally, since there is no disturbance to that particular soil mass, naturally it experiences at rest state. So whatever pressure that is exerted in the horizontal direction and whatever stress that we have in the vertical direction, if you consider that, then the lateral earth pressure is defined in this particular form, and it is called as earth pressure at rest. This is commonly used in theoretical basis, but in practice it is not generally considered except in few cases. Like for example, in case of pile foundation design, the earth pressure, lateral earth pressure, generally they consider is the at rest state. But as I told you already, it is not so common in practice to consider this at rest state, and it is basically theoretical one, or purely from the point of theoretical analysis. The next state we talk about is what we call active state. Now, to understand this active state, let us assume the wall which is retaining the soil mass on the backfill side here, if it tends to move in this direction, that is away from the backfill, if it tries to move away from the backfill in this way, then naturally there will be a formation of what we call failure wedge on the backfill side. This entire soil mass, okay, there is a bifurcation between this backfill soil mass and this wedge, whatever it is going to form. This wedge is known as failure wedge. So when there is a tendency for the wall to move like this, then naturally this failure wedge will try to move downward like this. So thereby there will be a shearing resistance between these two planes here, by the interaction over here. And if you consider here, as there is a tendency for the wall movement here, the horizontal stress, that is nothing but the lateral pressure here, it decreases. The reason for that is, here naturally before the wall movement, this entire mass is in some state. When the wall tries to move like this, naturally the particles here will be relaxed, and naturally there will be a decrease in the lateral pressure. This I can give it as an analogy with the, you just imagine yourself that you are inside a jam packed bus, and at one particular station, if for some number of passengers, if they get down, and naturally you will get space inside the bus and you will be relieved out of the pressure. Same way here also, the particles which are present in the failure wedge, okay, here when the wall starts tilting or wall starts moving, a tendency to move, naturally here these are all in a state of relaxation, and thereby there will be a decrease in this stress. And this stress reaches a minimum value, it keeps on decreasing until it reaches a minimum value, at which we say this attained a plastic equilibrium. In soil mechanics, when we say plastic equilibrium, it means that each and every particle of the soil mass is about to or tend to fail at that particular state. So that stage, when it is reached, this magnitude of sigma 3 or in lateral direction, whatever we are seeing here, it will be minimum. And this minimum stress, we call it as active stress or active lateral earth pressure. And naturally here, in this case, this sigma 3 is less than sigma 1, and hence thereby sigma 1 is major principal stress and sigma 3 here is minor principal stress. And in case of active state, naturally vertical stress is taken as sigma 1 and horizontal stress, which is nothing but the active earth pressure, active earth pressure we are calling it as, is the sigma 3 minor principal stress. And the relation between these two, the ratio of horizontal to vertical stress, is given by sigma 3 is equal to Ka into sigma 1, and Ka is nothing but active earth pressure coefficient. So as we seen earlier, K naught is commonly employed for, say, mentioning the at rest earth pressure coefficient, but Ka is given for active earth pressure coefficient. So in the similar fashion, when we go for this, that is when the wall tends to move towards the backfill. In the previous case, we have seen wall tending to move away from the backfill. Now it is moving towards the backfill. Naturally, when this again, if there will be a formation of failure wedge, and which tries to push this, the wall tries to push the soil wedge in the upward direction in this way. So naturally, the soil particles present over here will experience a higher magnitude of compression, and thereby the horizontal stress increases over here, and this reaches a maximum. And at that state, naturally the soil mass will reach what we call plastic equilibrium. So when it reaches plastic equilibrium, the maximum magnitude of stress in the horizontal direction is called as passive earth pressure. And here naturally this sigma 1 will be higher than sigma 3, that is horizontal stress will be higher than the vertical stress, and thereby this becomes major principal stress and this becomes minor principal stress. And if again, if you compare here, the minor principal stress we are taking it as vertical stress, and major principal stress we are taking as horizontal stress here, and that is called as passive earth pressure indicated by sigma p. And again, if you take the ratio of those two, sigma v to sigma h to sigma v, then naturally it will be sigma 1 is equal to kp into sigma 3, and this kp is nothing but passive earth pressure coefficient. So we have defined three states of earth pressure. One is the at rest case, second one is active case, the third one is passive case. These three states, they depend upon the movement or the strain experienced by the soil particles in the soil mass. If the strain experienced by the soil mass is expansion, then it will be active case. If the case is compression, as we have seen in case of wall tilting towards the backfill, it will be a passive case. And if there is no expansion or compression of the soil mass, then naturally it will be what we call static equilibrium. So in that such a case, the earth pressure that is going to develop, we call it as the at rest earth pressure. So these are the three states that an earth pressure can exist, and depending upon what kind of strain that is experienced by this soil mass. So if you look at the variation of this active earth pressure and passive earth pressure and earth pressure at rest, if you plot the things relating to the movement of the wall, so here I am showing on this side the wall moving away from the backfill. So here from this this is the position. From here it is moving away from the backfill. On this side I am plotting the towards the backfill when the ball moves, and naturally as it moves, higher the magnitude of compression, the higher will be the magnitude of passive stress or passive earth pressure, and it increases and reaches a maximum over here. And similarly for active case, when it decreases, the stress decreases as the wall move away from the backfill or tend to move away from the backfill, and it reaches a minimum value when the soil mass reaches plastic equilibrium. And you can observe here the pattern. And one thing what you can observe is the amount of movement required to mobilize this lateral earth pressure, the active lateral earth pressure, is very, very small when compared to the requirement when it is passive case. That is, this lateral movement required is quite large compared to the movement of the wall over here in case of active case, and this is the one which is indicating at rest state. So lateral pressure at rest state, and from there it decreases over here, and in case of active case, and if it is passive case it increases up to a maximum value like this. And if you calculate the earth pressure coefficients, then it will be in this particular table I am just mentioning the typical ranges of earth pressure coefficients for cohesionless soils and cohesive soils. Here you can observe for a passive case it can range anywhere from 3 to 14 for cohesionless soils, whereas for cohesive soils it is around 1 to 2. So now we can compare that value, that of at rest as well as that of active case. So here if you observe for active case, it will be in the range of 0.33 to 0.22. So naturally you can make out the enormous amount of difference between these two over here. So this is true because the amount of force required to produce this passive case, to bring it to plastic equilibrium, naturally larger amount of displacement is required over here, whereas in active case even a small amount of displacement is enough, or tendency to move is sufficient to mobilize this, and hence active case will be very small. So the earth pressure coefficients ranges are provided over here in this particular fashion. This is actually the reference taken from the foundation engineering by Bowles. So naturally we have defined the lateral earth pressure, and it is the earth pressure exerted by the soil mass over the retaining structure in the horizontal direction, and this can exist in three different states. That's what we have already seen: at rest state, active state and passive state. And when it is going to happen also we have seen, like the at rest state when there is no expansion or compression in the soil mass at rest state, and when there is a tendency for the particles to relax, when the tendency to move away, then naturally it is the active case, and when there is a compression, naturally it is the passive case. And these things are define that ratio of the horizontal pressure, lateral earth pressure, to vertical stress. If you define, that is called as coefficient of earth pressure. And again, related to these three states, we have defined three coefficients, namely earth pressure coefficient at rest, earth pressure coefficient at active state, or in other words, active earth pressure coefficient, the last one, passive earth pressure coefficient. So this is how we define the earth pressure and the coefficient of earth pressure. Then comes how to determine this earth pressure. Qualitatively we have talked, quantitatively how to find out. There are number of theories that are present, namely Coulomb theory, Rankine's theory, log spiral theory, so on. But most commonly employed one in practice is the Coulomb and the Rankine theory. These are the two theories which are well established and people are using from long back about this earth pressure computations or analysis of earth pressure. Before going to the details of this theory, I would like to explain the same concept whatever we have seen for active case, passive case and earth pressure coefficients with the help of a Mohr circle. For that I will use the blackboard and we will see how we can represent the same thing with the help of a Mohr circle diagram. So if I plot normal stress over shear stress, and if I assume this is the point at which we have at pressure at rest pressure, then this is the failure envelope for a given soil sample. Assuming that there is no, it is only phi soil, then naturally we have a Mohr circle of this kind, which is nothing but vertical stress here sigma 3, which is equal to sigma naught here. So here this is at rest. At rest, the whatever the lateral pressure we have, that is seen over here. Next, if I go for active case, then it slightly decreases like this. It keeps on when the tendency is there until it touches the failure envelope in this particular fashion. So when it reaches over here, this is nothing but our sigma A, that is nothing but active earth pressure. So here you can observe it keeps on decreases, that sigma 3 value keeps on decreases over here over a range, and when it touches the Mohr envelope, okay, the failure envelope, naturally it has reached the plastic equilibrium. In plastic equilibrium state we have the earth pressure, what we call active case. And similar to this, if you go for a passive case, naturally here it increases like this, and finally it when it touches the envelope we have the plastic equilibrium, and this corresponding to this point we have what we call passive earth pressure. So from the concept of Mohr circle, one can explain in this particular form the variation of the active earth pressure and the passive earth pressure. So these are the points which I would like wanted to give you about the three states of earth pressures: at rest earth pressure, active state earth pressure and passive state earth pressure. And as I said, for the computation purpose we have large amount of theories available. Number of theories are available for the purpose of analyzing this earth pressure problems. And as I already said, the classical methods, which are grouped under classical methods, the Coulomb theory and the Rankine theory. So if you look at the period there in 1776 itself, the person C.A. Coulomb has presented the methodology for the purpose of analyzing this lateral earth problem. And in 1857, after almost a decade, Rankine has presented a theory for the purpose of giving the analyzing the problem of earth pressure. So in spite of these two theories, which are old enough, decades back, in spite of it, okay, so these two theories are still used in practice for the purpose of solving various types of earth pressure problems. So these two theories, which we are going to discuss in future classes, we are going to see how the theories are presented, in what form, and what are the what are the basic assumptions made in these theories, and how applicable they are for our practical purposes, and using those assumptions and using the methodology given by those theories, will develop the expressions for the purpose of computing the earth pressure. So naturally we are going to look at the various types of equations developed from this theory. Okay. So we'll see this particular thing in the next class. What are the basic assumptions in Rankine theory and basic assumptions in Coulomb theory? Okay. So this is actually we are in this particular session. Actually, we have taken the problem of lateral earth pressure. We have defined the importance of lateral earth pressure, so that where we are using the lateral earth pressure and for what purpose one need to understand the concept of lateral earth pressure. And here we discussed about the importance of the lateral earth pressure by looking at the various applications in the form of retaining structures. So various types of retaining walls at various places in civil engineering practice we have seen. In civil engineering practice, retaining walls are quite common. It is used in all sorts of transportation infrastructure facilities. It is used in hydraulic and irrigation engineering field. It is used in many other civil engineering activities. So thereby, naturally, lot of importance is to be given for this retaining structure design, safety of retaining structure. So naturally, when we talk about the design aspect of the retaining structure, the major thing one should understand is the concept of lateral earth pressure, and that's what we have discussed in this particular session. So we have seen how exactly lateral earth pressure is going to develop. That is the horizontal pressure that is going to exert by the soil mass. We understood in the form of three states that is going to exist in the soil mass in the three states: at rest state, passive state, and as well as active state. So those three states of earth pressure we have discussed, and accordingly we have defined three coefficients, namely at rest coefficient, earth pressure coefficient, active earth pressure coefficient, and passive earth pressure coefficient. So these are the three lateral earth pressure coefficients we have defined in this particular session. And then in order to analyze the problems associated with the lateral earth pressure while solving the problems in connection with the retaining structures or any other kinds of structures which are associated with the lateral earth pressure, there are number of theories available for the purpose of analysis and design. And we are using out of several theories, two main theories which are well established in our field of civil engineering, namely Coulomb theory and Rankine theory of earth pressures. So in the next class, we are going to look at the basics of these two theories, Coulomb theory and Rankine theory. To start with, I am going to discuss about the basic assumptions made in these two theories, and finally we are going to look at the methodology of implementing these two theories in solving our earth pressure problems. So wish you all the best. We'll meet in the next class to discuss about the earth pressure theories. Thank you all.